the month of May is just not a month that I take lightly, and I put a lot of thought into the whole month because it's just really important to me.
Navigating the world with chronic Lyme disease. With service dog Sonoma by my side. Determined to make the best out of each day. And raise awareness. This is me. And this is Chronically Cassidy.
To kick off Lyme Disease Awareness Month, I asked my friend Emily Bottinick if she was interested in collaborating in a video with me. Thank you, Emily, for being a part of this video and helping to spread awareness for Lyme disease.
Hi, everyone. I'm coming at you today with my portion of this video. And my portion of this video is 20 questions for Cassidy. As you can see, I have them written down, and I'm going to ask them, and then she's going to answer them. So, let's get started, because there's quite a few here. Number one, the biggest question about Lyme disease I have is, how did you get Lyme if a tick didn't bite you? Because I know ticks are carriers of Lyme.
We are not sure how I got Lyme disease. My mom never remembers taking a tick off of me, and she would have remembered that. But that does not mean that I was not bit by a tick, because they're so ridiculously small, and when they're nymphs, they're even smaller. Even when they're engorged in blood after they bite you, they're still so small. So there is a very big chance that I was bit by a tick, but I didn't know. And especially where I live, with there being so much grass and a very residential area, it's a very big possibility. But it doesn't mean that I was bit by a tick, because Lyme can be spread by fleas, spiders, mosquitoes, other bugs, not just ticks. So there's really no way in directly knowing how I got Lyme disease.
Number two, is having Lyme painful? If so, explain, both mentally and physically. It could be painful, either one. So I want to know if it's that for you.
For me, Lyme disease is extremely painful. The first symptom of Lyme disease that I had, which we had no idea was related to Lyme disease 7 years ago, was nerve pain. And nerve pain is known as one of the worst pains, types of pain, or the worst type of pain to have, and the hardest type of pain to treat. And I've had that since I was 13 years old, and I have it my whole body, nerve pain. Nerve pain is stabbing pain, pricking pain. It feels like you're getting cut with razors. It's raw, bleeding skin. It feels like blisters popping. And I can get nerve pain just because I'm wearing a shirt and it touching like this burns. So that's really hard. I have a lot of other symptoms involving pain. I have had a chronic headache in the back of my head since I was 14 years old. I'm turning 20 in June, so that'll be about 6 years that I've had this headache every single day, waxing and waning. I also have muscle pain, joint pain, and the pain changes every day. I have nerve pain every day. I've never had a day without nerve pain since I can't remember. I guess since before I was 13. But all the other pain, it's every type of pain that you can think of. And it varies physically. There are so many different types of pain, and chronic Lyme certainly handles them all, unfortunately. Psychologically, Lyme disease is very hard and painful because it's made me miss out on a lot of things. I had to stop ballet dancing, which I've been doing since I was 3 years old. I had to stop when I was 16, and that was incredibly hard. I was a pre-professional dancer, and ballet was my ultimate passion, and I had to stop doing that. So that was huge. I wasn't in school. It was very isolating and lonely because I didn't have a lot of friends that kept up with me. So I really learned who my friends were.
How long have you had Lyme? So how long have you been diagnosed, or how long have you had symptoms?
This is another difficult question because we are not exactly sure how long I've had Lyme disease, as well as the four other tick-borne infections that I have and viruses. And that is because we don't know of a tick bite, of a mosquito bite, or anything. I started getting real symptoms noticeably when I was 13, which was the nerve pain, but I did have a slight symptom that we kind of brushed aside when I was 12, and that was the what you call typical lupus rash, the butterfly rash. It kind of looks like your skin is like got like cut on pavement, like pavement burn, I guess. And it's shaped like a butterfly like this. And I had that when I was 12. And I just got like cream for it. And we went on. And then it never came back. Sign of an autoimmune disease. And what do I have now? A bunch of autoimmune diseases. However, I wasn't diagnosed with Lyme disease until I was 16. I was just about to turn 17. It was May. So I was diagnosed during Lyme Disease Awareness Month, which is pretty interesting. Although there will always be uncertainty as to when I was actually infected with Lyme disease and all of these other tick-borne diseases, my doctors think that it is possible that I got Lyme disease and these other infections when I was in elementary school. Because when I first started getting symptoms, they were not early symptoms, they were late stage symptoms. It's very possible that Lyme disease and the other infections were dormant in my body for some time before they actually became active.
Why do you need IVIG like Mary? And if you guys didn't know who Mary is Mary Fry. And she has IVIG as well for cystic fibrosis. And I didn't know that you could do IVIG for Lyme, so I want to know why you have IVIG like Mary.
I have actually had IVIG for multiple reasons. The first time I got IVIG was for hypogammaglobulinemia, which means I basically had a low immune system, and IVIG is intravenous immunoglobulin, and it helps boost your immune system. Now, after that helped, and my immune system came back up. And IVIG can work in multiple ways for multitudes of different diseases and disorders. It can help boost your immune system, which lots of people do for their illness. And it can also modulate or change your immune system because it's literally immune systems from other people's bodies coming into you. So I have a disorder called autoimmune encephalitis, and that means autoimmune is my body attacking itself, and encephalitis means inflammation in my brain. So my body is attacking my own brain and causing it to be inflamed. So IVIG is to help my immune system to stop attacking my brain and maybe start attacking the other things like the Lyme disease and the things that it needs to attack. And I also have chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy, which is nerve damage, and IVIG is also to help that. And it helps tons of things in addition, like seizures and cognition problems that go along with Lyme disease. So it's usually used with very neurological Lyme patients. I've been on treatment for about 3 years in total for Lyme disease and all the things that come with it. And I think by far IVIG has been the most helpful thing. And I'm so thankful for it.
How does your service dog Sonoma help you with your Lyme disease diagnosis?
My service dog Sonoma does a lot of things for me that helps me being sick. He grabs my medication bag by an alarm on my phone because I am forgetful because I've lost cognition due to Lyme disease. So if I just set my phone alarm to go off at 5 different times a day and the alarm goes off, he will go and get a bag of medicine. And we're also going to put medicine inside his vest. He's also great for mobility because I have times that sometimes come out of nowhere when I'm unable to walk. He retrieves items for me when I'm in bed just too sick and can't get it. He will open the door for me. He will go get my mom if I need him to. He will turn the lights on and off for me. He will lay in front of me during a seizure because as a ballet dancer, I'm pretty flexible, so I will literally just kick myself in the head during a seizure. And I've caused some pretty bad damage and broken a paramedic's laptop during a seizure in an ambulance once. He creates a barrier for me to not hurt myself during seizures. So he works a seizure response, and the more that we have him, we notice that he also alerts for seizures. And that's not something that you can train dogs. That's something that dogs either have or they don't. And Sonoma has it because he alerted me the other day and I didn't really know it was an alert because I didn't know what he wanted. He just came up to me and like nudged me. And 10 minutes later, I had a seizure. He helps with independence, walking around stores, not letting people touch my back because that is a very, very severe sensitive trigger point. It will cause an atonic seizure, which means I will completely collapse to the floor and not be able to use my muscles. So he can create a barrier by standing behind me or sitting behind me so people won't brush into me. He lets me be independent more than I have been, and he will allow me to be able to go to college and have a lifeline that I'm not alone and that I have this great dog that I can count on.
Does anyone else in your family have Lyme?
Nobody else in my family has Lyme. My dad did have Lyme when I was very, very young, or maybe not even born, but he got a tick bite, a rash. He had the very textbook, what you would call version of Lyme disease, joint pain, and was treated immediately. Because he was treated immediately, he is living a completely healthy life and has had no problems. My grandmother had a tick bite a year or so ago, sometime during the summer, and she had no symptoms, but we convinced her, wasn't hard to convince her, to go to my Lyme specialist and get tested anyways, because you don't have to have symptoms right away. And it ended up that she did not have Lyme disease, but she had another tick-borne infection instead. So they treated her for that infection. She still had no symptoms because they didn't let it escalate to that point. Right now, she is 80 years old, and I swear she just keeps getting younger and healthier every day.
Did you develop your seizures because of Lyme?
Yes, I did develop seizures due to chronic Lyme disease. But on the other hand, I have multiple infections like Babesia, Bartonella, and Ehrlichia, which are tick-borne diseases, and other viral infections. So You can't be positive if the seizures are from chronic Lyme, chronic Bartonella, chronic Babesia, etc., because the symptoms interlock so much and are so similar or the same. Also, autoimmune encephalitis, a very common symptom, is seizures. It all just goes back to the root cause of these tick-borne infections.
What kind of doctor treats Lyme, and or what are some treatments you go through to deal with your Lyme?
There are many doctors that will treat Lyme, but that does not mean that they treat Lyme correctly. The doctors that know how to treat Lyme disease correctly are certified by ILADS. That's called, or stands for, the International Lyme and Associated Disease Society. So, doctors that correctly treat Lyme disease are known as LLMDs, or Lyme Literate Medical Doctors. There's also LLPA, Lyme Literate Physician's Assistant, Lyme Literate RN, Registered Nurse, all things LL just means Lyme Literate. Also, naturopaths, a lot of naturopaths treat Lyme disease. And I go to a naturopath and a Lyme Literate Specialist for Lyme disease. I also go to a Lyme Literate Neurologist who is certified by ILADS. And if you want more information on ILADS, go to ILADS.org. Infectious disease doctors will treat the early stages of Lyme, but they often will say that chronic Lyme is not real and will not treat past 2 weeks to 30 days of antibiotics, which is why infectious disease doctors are not the doctors to go to when you have chronic Lyme. I do a very full body approach. I do a lot of integrative medicine, which means it's not just pills from the pharmacy and it's not just herbs from the garden. It's a little bit of everything. It could be a little bit of Chinese medicine. It could be some Reiki, and I don't even know where Reiki comes from, to be honest. And then there are conventional things like the oral and the IV antibiotics. And then there are all the different energetic things that go back to like China and places I don't even know because it's so confusing, it goes right over my head. We do know for sure that I'm going to be on IVIG for quite a while until a lot of my symptoms go away, because it certainly helps me a lot.
How has Lyme changed your life in a positive way? And how has Lyme changed your life in a negative way?
Lyme disease has affected me positively in so many ways. It made me extremely interested in the medical field. That has caused me to want to pursue a career as a physician's assistant, inspired by a Lyme literate physician's assistant who I love. It has caused me to be way more empathetic to other people and be grateful for the little things that people take for granted every day. I cannot shower when my port that is unaccessed right now, I can shower. When it is accessed, I cannot shower. So I am grateful for the one day a week I can shower when I change my needle. And I'm grateful for being able to take baths, because sometimes I can't take baths. I'm grateful to be able to go to work with my mom and work a few hours a week. I got a service dog because of Lyme disease, and it's not ideal to have to need a service dog, but so many great things have come out of that, just having him as a companion, having him help me. It's helped me become friends with a lot of people who have Lyme disease, as well as other illnesses that don't have anything to do with Lyme disease. It's given me a lot more wisdom and made me a lot more mature. Lyme disease has affected me in a negative way due to all the pain and suffering that I shouldn't have to go through at a young age. It has made me a lot stronger because of those pains, but it doesn't make the pain, the appointments, and the stress any easier. It gives me a way bigger outlook on life and makes me set even bigger goals for myself. And it has made me want to advocate for Lyme disease, when before I didn't know anything more about Lyme disease than the average person walking down the street, which is not a lot. Lyme disease did make me have to stop dancing for now, but I will tell you that ballet dancing is not being hung up. I am going to get back to ballet eventually. It has caused me to be extremely resilient, even more resilient than I was, and want to advocate for Lyme. And I've had a lot of heartbreaking moments from it, losing friends that I thought were friends that I realized were just friends when it was convenient, and then kind of dropped me basically when I was sick. And that was really, really hard. Not being in college when all of your friends you graduated with are in college is hard. It's hard to be isolated a lot all day. I love my mom to death. We are best friends, but I literally spend all my time with my mom. So I don't get to see my friends. They're in college, or they're not around, or they live in a different state and I can't see them. So that's difficult. The biggest way Lyme disease has affected me in a negative way has been all the years prior to being diagnosed with Lyme disease, when so many doctors told me it was in my head, I was faking it, I didn't want to go to school, I was stressed, I was being an annoying teenager who wants attention, I needed to try harder. I had so many doctors and people not believe me, and I knew I was right. And I diagnosed myself with Lyme myself after watching the movie Under Our Skin. And sorry, doctors who went to medical school for like 15 years, but I was the one who was right about that. But I went through so many years of people just saying, I don't know what's wrong with you, your kid's fine, go to school, suck it up. And I am a really type A personality, go-getter person. So this kid would not miss school. Absolutely not. People, doctors, not believing me, telling me that I need psychology to come in and help me, and I need a therapist, and that none of what I was saying was true, was really, really bad. And I will definitely never forget some of those people's faces, and I really wish I could go back and tell them that they were wrong.
Number 11, I know you work very hard with some different Lyme organizations, so I was just wondering, have any of those organizations or anything like that, researchers or anything, come up with a cure for Lyme yet?
Lyme disease is extremely controversial because the CDC does not believe it exists, but ILADS believes it exists. And trust me, I am living it. Chronic Lyme is real. when treated right away, like at the first sign of a tick bite or the first sign of early stage symptoms, Lyme disease can be cured, but it is controversial if it can be cured for chronic patients, patients who have been misdiagnosed for 5, 10, 15, 20, or like half of their lives. It's no joke. The CDC will say, yes, there's a cure, but it is uncertain. The goal right now for me is to be in remission, to be off of these medications. I don't mind taking supplements, but to be way down on these things and to be living a normal life, symptom-free. Lyme disease does go dormant in your body. It can go dormant in your body and then come out in certain times of stress, illness, or injury. So there are chances of relapse for chronic Lyme. And of course, I think the best, and I want to think the best, but I know that because of that, Lyme disease is so hard to treat. You can't get every little bit of bacteria out of your system past a certain point that we know of right now. So I am very well aware that I know I'm going to go into remission eventually, but I also know that there is a chance that I can have a relapse of chronic Lyme disease.
Have you ever met another friend or another person with Lyme?
I have met 4 people face-to-face with chronic Lyme disease. Kira, Megan, Jess, and I have become such close friends, and Megan is actually coming over to spend like 11 days at my house to work on shadowing her own doctor who lives and works in my state, and she's going to be spending her days sleeping over at my house while she shadows to learn about Lyme disease more and spend my birthday with me. So that's going to be really awesome. Kira and Megan and I have become such great friends. It's amazing. I also have other friends that I've met only once. I have met my friend Abby in person. She came to a fundraiser that I did that is on this channel. I have not seen her since. It's been a really long time, so I want to get together with her. And I also have other friends. I have another friend named Abby, but these girls are out of state and we're all busy with schedules and doctor's appointments and things going on that we haven't been able to meet up face to face.
Is Lyme a well-known illness?
I think that the word Lyme disease or the term Lyme disease is a well-known illness, but the reality of Lyme disease is not well-known. Chronic Lyme disease is not well-known. I think most people know that Lyme disease comes from a tick, even though it's more than that, but most people know really nothing to what Lyme disease is really about.
What is the most annoying thing about having Lyme?
By far, the most annoying thing about Lyme disease is the lack of awareness and lack of knowledge and the amount of doctors that say chronic Lyme is not real and say that we are all asking for attention.
Is there days when you feel better at all, or do you deal with Lyme all the time? Like, do you deal with Lyme symptoms all the time? Like, or is there days that you feel completely symptom-free?
I have a lot of different Lyme symptoms, and they definitely wax and wane, and I will have my
bad days and my worst days and my better days, but I do not have days right now where I'm completely symptom free. I do not have days where I do not deal with Lyme disease.
If somebody recently just got diagnosed with Lyme, what advice would you give them?
I would give them some very good sites to look into, because there's a lot of wrong information on the internet regarding Lyme disease because of the controversy. And due to that controversy, I encourage everyone, whether you think you have Lyme disease or not, to go watch the movie Under Our Skin, and then go ahead and watch the sequel, Under Our Skin 2 Emergence. I would recommend everyone who is recently diagnosed with Lyme disease to go to ilads.org, lymedisease.org, tiredoflyme.com, and follow my page, Fight Lyme for Life, on Facebook, because I post a lot of facts about Lyme disease and tick-borne diseases. And it's also extremely important to find the right doctor. Don't just go to any neurologist. They are not going to help you. Trust me, I've been to many. You have to go to Lyme-literate doctors, and that is through ILADS. And unfortunately, a lot of them don't take insurance, but some of them do. So I would encourage people who are recently diagnosed with Lyme to find a naturopath or a Lyme-literate physician through ILADS, to not go to an infectious disease doctor, and to get tested through Igenics, which is a very good lab in California, because the tests for Lyme disease are extremely inaccurate. And also to be your own advocate, because there are still people today who will tell me that I don't have chronic Lyme disease. Crazy as it sounds. But you gotta learn to ignore the people who don't make any sense and go with the people that are helping you get better, and always trust your gut.
Based on your videos, I saw that you were recently in the hospital. So, what were you recently in the hospital for, and does it have anything to do with Lyme?
I was recently in the hospital for a severe skin infection, and it does have to do with Lyme disease, because the infection can be caused by an autoimmune skin disease that I have.
In your videos, you mentioned the all-important Lyme diet. What is it, and why is it so important that it is so strictly followed?
The Lyme diet, I don't know why I use air quotes on that, because it is a real thing, is eating no refined sugar. There's a difference between refined sugar and natural sugar. Dairy, gluten / yeast, alcohol, which doesn't pertain to me because I'm underage, and processed food, and to eat organic, and basically just eat healthy. And the reason why that is so important is because our bodies with Lyme disease are filled with inflammation. Gluten, because it is so refined, the products that have gluten in it, like bread, and they also have tons of sugar in them, cause a lot of inflammation due to overprocessing. Sugar, refined sugar, causes a lot of inflammation in your body, no matter who you are, and no matter what disease you have or don't have. Sugar causes inflammation, and we don't want to add fuel to the fire, so we're trying to avoid the things that could cause symptoms to flare. And I've gotten so good at following the Lyme diet that if I were to splurge and have something with gluten in it, I get extremely sick because my body is so used to being without gluten or sugar. And dairy is the same thing. It can cause inflammation. Some people find that they get acne on their skin when they have dairy. Acne is inflammation. So maybe try going dairy-free. There are so many things you can do, even though it seems like it's so restrictive to not have any processed food or all that. People follow it to varying degrees of people who don't follow the Lyme diet at all, which I honestly think is a very not smart choice, and people that follow it religiously, which is me. Definitely. Lyme disease, the bacteria itself, Borrelia burgdorferi, actually feeds off of sugar. So if you want to get rid of the bacteria in your body, you want to starve it of what it eats. And some people find that it helps their symptoms a lot. And some people don't notice a difference, but either way, it makes you so much healthier and it's so worth it.
If you had kids, could you pass on Lyme to them? Like, is it genetic or is it just that you had it and then, like, you know, that's just it? Like, you had it and that's it.
Lyme disease is not a genetic disease, but it can be passed down from mother to a child, which is a very big concern of soon-to-be mothers or people who want to be mothers of passing Lyme disease that they have to their children. Lyme disease is also an STD, so you can get it from your husband and then pass it on to your child or give it to your husband or partner or whoever. So that is a problem.
And number 20, with you having a service dog, as anybody knows, dogs, no matter if they're working or not, they could get ticks. And I know that ticks are a huge carrier of Lyme. How do you keep yourself safe while still caring for your dog at the risk of ticks?
My mom and my family and myself follow a lot of precautions to make sure that my dog Richter and my service dog Sonoma are as safe as they can be from any tick-borne infection. We have our yard sprayed with a natural tick repellent. It is made of cedar oil, and we get the whole perimeter of our yard sprayed, and it is safe for the dogs. We also have both of our dogs wearing a tick and flea collar called a Seresto collar, and they have been working fantastic. It's way easier than putting the monthly tea in tea. I just love tea so much, I accidentally say tea in all my videos. Tick and flea repellent stuff on your dog's back, like the frontline stuff, because the collars last 8 months at a time before you need a new one. So Sonoma has a tick collar on. It's just like a rubberish silver, not really silver, gray collar, and so does Richter. And we also have spray for them, pet friendly of course, smells really really good, and we spray their paws and their stomach anytime they go outside. We check for ticks every time they come inside, and we just brush our hands through their fur and check for any lumpy things that are unusual and are always watching out for that. We also don't let the dogs run in tall grasses. Not like there really are tall grasses near us, but we are very careful with the dogs because We don't want them getting Lyme disease or any other tick-borne infection. Thank you so much to Emily Bottinick for helping out with this awareness video. I'm sure your questions were questions that a lot of people were also wondering, and it spread a lot of awareness. Emily also has her own YouTube channel, so I encourage you to check it out. I will leave a link in the description down below.